Recognizing quorum, I'm calling this meeting of the Cannabis Control Commission to order at 12:02 p.m. on October 4th, 2018. Can I ask everybody back in here? Thank you. Can I ask if anybody recorded this meeting? Let the public know that this meeting is being recorded. Can I ask everybody please to turn their cell phones off or put them on silent for you? Thank you. I just want to make a couple comments on the agenda before we start. This is a differently structured meeting than we've had in the past, and so I just want to make sure that everybody understood what we're going to do and have their expectations appropriately. This is going to be a two-day meeting. We will not adjourn, but we will recess at the end of today, and we have a hard stop at 2:30. We might recess sooner than that, but we have an absolute hard stop at 2:30. We will then reconvene at 9 o'clock on Tuesday morning at the Gaming Commission. It's the last slide. We've done that for several reasons. One is we did have constraints on both sides from various previous commitments, so we can only meet for 2.5 hours today. We have a very full agenda that I don't believe for dessert we're not going to get done in 2.5 hours, so we've agreed that we're going to extend the meeting to Tuesday. Couple of things. After the executive director's report, we will have the staff present their analysis and recommendations with respect to final licenses. There are four final licenses that are on the agenda for today. We will discuss those final licenses with the staff. We will have everybody ask some questions. It is possible, as we mentioned in the agenda we sent out earlier this week, it's possible that the nature of those questions will cause us to go into executive session. If so, we'll announce that. You can say we're going to leave and go to the room behind us for that executive session if necessary, and then we'll come back and continue the meeting and recess later on. So we're going to do that. We will then go through seven.
Alex?
I'm sure it was my fault. I'd love to blame Commissioner Boyle, but she's usually the one without the issues, but I'm sure this was just me. So after we discuss the final licenses, I also, before we move on, with respect to the four final licenses that will be presented and discussed, it is likely that we will not vote on them until the continuation of our meeting on Tuesday morning. We want to make sure that given the nature of this activity, how important it is, the fact that we're going to have the opportunity to ask questions and understand the recommendations of staff in detail, that we want to take some time just to digest and deliberate. So it is possible that we will not vote on the final licenses until Tuesday morning at the continuation of this meeting. Once we're done with our discussion on final licenses, we have 7 provisional licenses that the staff has recommended, and we will discuss and vote on those. And my expectation, and it's just an expectation, but my expectation is that will be when we recess on Tuesday after that agenda item. On Tuesday, or as the meeting continues, we have several other matters that I think are both important and will take some time. We have, as I think we've communicated, the municipal survey, thanks to the leadership of Commissioner Doyle. We have some data to review from that. As you will all recall, when we voted on our final regulations back in March, and it shows at that point not to license social consumption or home delivery, we said we would take those issues back up. And we put a finite timeline on it, which said we'd take them off in October. During the period between March and October, under the leadership of the executive director, our staff has done research on background in other states, experience in other states, whatever kind of academic research is there on these topics. And so the staff report will be presented around social consumption, and we will discuss and decide on next steps with respect to social consumption. Home delivery, which was deferred the same way, will be on the agenda at our next public meeting, which will be on October 18th. We also have one other issue that will require a vote, a discussion of vote, and that's the procurement of office space, both for our main office, which says to be located in Worcester, as well as our satellite office, which will be located in Boston vicinity. DCAM has, Department of Capital Asset Management and Maintenance, has asked that we conduct the discussion and vote in executive session so that they can retain negotiating position with respect to the chosen landlords, not knowing that others have not been chosen. And so we will have that vote in executive session on Tuesday, discussion and vote. We will adjourn from executive session on Tuesday. So, a little different structure. I hope everyone understands really the logic behind it. I have a lot to start with, so I'm going to leave my comments at that point and move directly to the agenda. You might have noticed we do not have any minutes to review at this meeting. We will have minutes at our next meeting on the 18th, but today there are no minutes to be reviewed. So the first item on the agenda is the executive director's report, starting with the introduction of a new employee. So, Mr. Executive Director,
sure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Wanted to first introduce the newest team member for the commission, and that is Jennifer Forsberg. Jennifer joins the commission as our human resources generalist. There she is. She comes to us most recently from the University of Massachusetts, the president's office, in Shrewsbury. As our HR generalist, she's responsible for supporting our payroll activities, our benefits administration, recruitment, onboarding, performance management, employee relations, compensation, and so she joins Erica White as our Chief People Officer in our Human Resources Department. So very excited to have Jennifer with us here for the commission. Welcome. That's it for as far as the general staffing update. We do have the commission's social line, a job description for you for consideration. The title of which is Licensing Analyst. We will report to the Director of Licensing, Kyle Hoppen. Enjoying the licensing team, which is as of today consists of Kyle and Suko as a licensing specialist. The difference here as far as analyst is helping Kyle in evaluating the substance of applications and vetting establishments and establishment agents for registration as well. This is someone who will look to analyze a lot of the materials that do come in. As you know, we have applications that are pending for establishments, but also with the agent registration process, again, making sure that we bolster up that staff so we can remain as diligent and as efficient as possible and building out Kyle's team. So now, if you have any questions you might have about the licensing analyst, to anticipate your question, Mr. Chairman, this is something that this budget is for, we'll move it into our organizational structure.
And when would you post and when would you expect to fill this position?
I would hope to post as soon as possible to then give enough time for folks to apply and start building out the hiring process. So, if not, this would be certainly
answered. Other questions? Commissioner McBride?
I was looking to have Kyle
well, trying to forecast is not an easy task, but at this point, we wanted to support Kyle and Supro in that department today. Questions? I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
I can talk closer to the mic, but
that's thank you. I appreciate that.
I said it's great to see our licensing team expanding, and then I have one question, which is the bullet points serve as a subject matter expert in the areas of licensing. I'm just wondering what that means to serve as a subject matter expert, and also if there's any related qualifications.
I think subject matter expert is really invaluable in the application itself, what materials are necessary as far as determining the application first be complete and then evaluating those. I don't know that skill set exactly exists aside from Kyle and Suko today, given where we stand as a Commonwealth, but really it's essentially looking for someone to develop that skill set or have a similar skill set to evaluate the substance of the application that might involve any of the materials. So, obviously, it's the government experience that might be relevant, the government experience that might be relevant, really evaluate the substance of the application process. Both are sufficient.
Other questions? And can I have a motion, please, to approve the job description?
So moved. Second.
Let the record show that Commissioner Dorn on the motion to approve, second by Commissioner Klein, and all in favor.
Aye.
Let the record show that Commissioner Nasty approved the job description for licensing analyst. Thank you very much, and good luck.
Thank you.
Next on the agenda, Mr. Detective Director.
You the licensing video?
Yeah, I think it's the right here on the licensing status. This is the first slide here. Want to go through it?
Great. So these are the usual slides that you'll be familiar with. Is first a high-level overview of our licensing portal and the applications that we're evaluating on an ongoing basis. There are 2,943 total applications in some way pending. 819 of those are pending, at least one packet having been submitted, 214 been withdrawn, 1,821 remaining complete. Of course, the commission to date has issued 30 individual licenses, and a new bullet there is that there's 51 agent applications that have been evaluated and approved administratively by staff. And the pending 819 are in the right-hand column for your review. You see there's 600 agent applications that are pending in some way, which is something that's valued in the future.
Okay. Any questions? Keep going, please.
Okay, so this is, again, the four packets having been submitted. The first step, of course, is to evaluate for completeness. There are 153 applications that are pending in that status. There are three independent testing labs, 49 cultivation, 4 micro business, 41 product manufacturer, 3 research, 50 retail, 1 third party with an existing transportation, sorry, third party transporter, and 2 with an existing marijuana establishment license. That is a total of 153. The difference is 10 that have come in since the last commission meeting. 81 with R&D priority, 3 with economic empowerment priority, 69 general applicants. Those 153 applications represent 78 different entities.
Thank you. Further questions? This is what's happening, please. There's a third party transport that is joining the LT that's in support for our new strength. It's good news. Are there other questions or comments?
So, previously discussed in past meetings, this is of those 153 evaluations where they stand in our internal review process. That is, 26 have not been reviewed yet and therefore awaiting review. As a reminder, those include the 10 that have come in the past 2 weeks or the intervening time in the commission meetings. 43 have been reviewed and require additional information. 39 are out for external response, and that includes both municipal as well as the background check. 7 are pending before the commission today for consideration. The commission issued previously 38 provisional licenses, and that's your total for 153.
Questions? I think you start with the map.
Sure. So the map is a familiar graphic for the commission. I'll just indicate where there's differences from the previous meeting. That is one additional in Berkshire County, one additional in Hampshire County, 5 additional in Worcester County, 1 additional in Essex County, and one additional in Bristol County, and 1 additional in Plymouth.
So I think I'll call that we asked the executive director at the previous meeting to, once we authorize the staff to do the process of agent approval, we asked for a regular update on how that process worked in terms of the graphics. And so the next few slides cover that. Thank you very much for doing so.
So the first slide here indicates the volume of total applications for agents. As I indicated previously, there are 600 that are pending, 106 have been withdrawn, 440 remain complete, and 51 to date have been approved. Of those 600, though, there are 484 that are awaiting review from staff. 25 have been reopened and we've requested additional information. 21 are awaiting a third-party response. In the context of agent registrations, in particular, lab agents are required to be fingerprinted, so that would be that third-party response. And 70 have been reviewed and are just awaiting a final analysis of approval.
Okay. Okay. Other questions?
One question.
Yes.
So these are submitted by the establishment on behalf of the agent, right?
Sure.
106 withdrawn seems unexpectedly high. Do you have any insight into why so many were withdrawn?
I do not. It could be that there are multiple folks at the establishment that are submitting them, if there's a duplicate, that's one possibility, that's one pure speculation on my part. I don't know, Kyle, do you have any indications for this remaining setting for that?
No, I'd say that the executive director's analysis as far as duplicated applications to agents is probably the leading factor. I have seen a lot of that, so I'd say that people need to back out of the back.
Thank
you. And we reopen it just sort of further as to as far as that we will reopen that application with the additional information we would be requesting. By and large, would be if the data doesn't match, for instance, the date of birth is indicated in the application but is not reflected in the ID that's been given, because we're going to reconcile that information, or if the ID or information has been supplied to an expired license or identification card, we would seek to get an updated version of that just so we have accurate information.
Other questions? Next slide, this is the demographics. I'm referring to the approvals and applicants.
So, given that the commission's interest in kind of the folks that are working within the industry or those who work within the industry, this is information we're capturing in the application. We're therefore able to extract it. So, I thought that just be valuable to present it on an ongoing basis so we can have a sense of the demographic breakdown of the agents that are proposed or approved in the industry. This is a total 650 lots. This is the folks that are pending, as well as those that have been approved. So it's a complete snapshot as of the applications are pending for today. So you'll see that there are predominantly male, 66%, and 32% female. We do have the option of folks declining to answer, and also the option for folks to identify their own gender in the application.
We're glad. Any questions on this slide? Next slide is, I think, looking at race and ethnicity.
That's correct. So, in the context of the application, we also collect information on the proposed agents, or the, in some cases, approved agents, race or ethnicity. You see a breakdown here based on again, the total volume as well as the percentage that happens.
Great questions or comments, Commissioner Brown?
My reaction to this information is first that it's quite early days. In terms of evaluating this, and we should probably treat it as a baseline. But to provide context for it, I also looked at it in comparison to the most recent census data to see whether or not the information was consistent. And I was disappointed to note that, in fact, Massachusetts is more diverse than marijuana agents in Massachusetts at this point. So I would just comment that I'm going to be keeping a close eye on this personally, looking at what we can do to incentivize and encourage diversity in the hiring of marijuana agents and retention of marijuana agents going forward, including potentially reevaluating portions of the regulations on this issue.
Do we have a sense of how many of the applicants for agent are from existing R&Ds? So in other words, currently employed potentially by existing R&Ds and therefore the R&D may just be turning them over into from the R&D into an adult use space?
Without having a very specific number of people, I can say it'd be significant, if not all. But I don't want to characterize this all, I'm not being able to certainly say that, but the folks that have processed to date would be tied to our provisional licenses, and those predominantly represent existing RVs or proposed co-located facilities. And by and large, I would imagine that the proposed staff would be the same folks that are also registered in the department.
Thank you. So I think with that in mind, I concur with what Commissioner Doyle just said. I think that we are now reaching a point, a point has already gone by, in fact, I think, where we really do need to be thinking in all ways about how to increase diversity in this, the agent registration process and generally in the industry. And so I would like to, I think that having these numbers is really beneficial to us. I want to continue to get these numbers, and I want to be thinking about what we need to be doing in terms of possible regulatory changes down the line to be addressing that issue.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. And to add to what Commissioner McBride said, I think this is maybe another thing that we can do is take a look at what the industry is doing and the applicants are doing for their proposals on how to positively impact the disproportionately affected areas, because there have been some that I have questions on with how impactful they really will be, or are they just trying to fulfill what a mandate is. So maybe it's also a piece of it is to take a look at what the industry side is going to participate in this and hold them accountable.
I think it's very critical. Thank you. I think it's very critical. My pleasure that this is a mandate that's requirement of the commission, so I think the right thing to do is to require it and also the legislation. Yeah, also in the legislation is the requirement that we report back to the legislature on how we're doing, and if we are not doing a good job of this, to report back on what we're going to do differently to improve our performance on this. So this is a topic that I think we'll continually monitor and continually discuss, and we'll continue to iterate until we get this right. Mr. Tyler?
I'm going to agree with Commissioner Doyle that I would also consider this to be very much baseline data, especially if you look at our ownership data, which I believe will happen in the next meeting, that is from scratch what the commission has approved, whereas in this case, all of the existing licensees were already operating and I presume had their own employees. So that's something for us to keep an eye on. I know that earlier these companies didn't have the diversity plan requirement or a positive impact plan requirement, although I'm sure they took that seriously, they didn't have the requirement. So we can keep an eye on this as a way to measure the programs that were implemented. And I also want to agree that this is something we want to adjust appropriately as it relates to the programs we put in place watching this data. I really appreciate the staff taking the initiative to bring us this data on their own accord. I think it's an expression of how seriously this entire agency and staff take this mandate, both legally and just on principle. And I would also note, I believe the only other state that collects and releases data like this is Maryland for its medical program. And I know that when other states are crafting their legalization laws, they really want to see this. So I think this will do a service nationally as well.
Let me just ask, since this is the first time we've seen these data, are there other requests from with respect to data they'd like to see on this topic, or is this sufficient? This is the first time we did such one. This is the feedback. I'm sure that we're both collecting and disseminating the information that people are looking for. Anything else you'd like to see in future meetings from the executive director's report? Okay, then let me ask you, Commissioner Tyler, thanks and appreciation to the staff for collecting this information. Anything else in your executive director report?
Not at this time, aside to say that, again, this is something we're going to continue to monitor and report on an ongoing basis. This is information that's supplied to us, and so we're taking that information. I think it also speaks to the value of our portal and our ability to extract data from it and to use it in a practical way for the commission's consideration. So this will continue to be an ongoing priority of mine as we build out additional systems to make sure that
Thank you. Okay. Any other questions before we move on to the next agenda? So the next agenda item is to review and discuss staff recommendations on final licenses. We have four final license applications. Three for Cultivate Holdings, Cultivation, Product Manufacturing, and Retailing, and then one for New England Treatment Access for Retailing. The intent would be to have the Executive Director on behalf of the Investigations and Enforcement staff go through the staff's recommendation and the rationale behind it. We have our Investigation and Enforcement staff sitting on my left, and they're available to have follow-up or answer follow-up questions from the Commission on the staff's recommendation. If there are questions that we deem are appropriate to take up executive direction, we're going to put it in executive session. We'll put them to the side. We'll go through all four of these, and then we will go into executive session if necessary to discuss the questions that we deem are inappropriate to discuss publicly. But let's go through all four. We're not going to go back and forth into executive session at my point. But let's start with number one, Cultivate Holdings LLC, MC281266, which is Tier 2 Cultivation. Mr. Executive Director.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And as you'll see from the materials that before you and the information we anticipate posting on the Commission's website immediately following the Commission's meeting is an executive summary of continuation of the executive summary that was previously provided from the entity Cultivation Holdings LLC. That executive summary does incorporate or encompass all three of their original licenses. That is Tier 2 Cultivation, which authorizes up to 10,000 square feet, a product manufacturer, a retailer. Those licenses would be housed or located in one physical address, that is 1764 Main Street in Leicester. As you recall, the Commission previously approved for provisional license their retail application on July 2nd, 2018, their cultivation license or provisional license on July 12th, and lastly, their product manufacturing license on August 23rd. Many of the conditions, or some of the conditions that replace the provisional status are referenced here, they've been satisfied. As their application fee has in fact been paid for each of these licenses, and no new information has been reported to the Commission staff during this proceeding phase regarding the organizational structure of the entity since the issuance of the Commission license. Similarly, no new information has been discovered by the Commission staff regarding suitability in this intervening phase on the licensee as an entity or any individuals that are associated with this provisional licenses or these provisional licenses, excuse me. As far as the inspection process, the initial inspection took place in Leicester on September 18th. The establishment was inspected by Commission staff, and this would be an appropriate time for me to acknowledge the work of our new investigators that really hit the ground running. That is Michael Lee, Chantal Porter, Colin Soper, and Rosa Pena under the supervision and management of Patrick B.A. as our director of investigations, and Yao Ji as our chief of investigations and enforcement. Similarly, I want to acknowledge the work of Kyle Hoffman as a director of licensing and Super Defoe as a licensing specialist. That team together really the folks that managed this process from initial application dated back to April this at this juncture to our moment now, which is the consideration of final license. So I'd like to mention the chaos at the moment, I'm aware of that now. That said, those folks were in that facility and found the facility to be in compliance with the requirements of our regulations. During the course of that investigation and that inspection as well, there's no evidence that indicated that the applicant was not in compliance with any applicable state or proposed bylaws, ordinances, or regulations. And I've brought out many or some of the findings from that investigation and that inspection that's before you for your consideration, which is that all persons must arrive at the front entrance when they're greeted by a security receptionist. That initial closures for security receptionists will review identification and maintain their visitor logs. In other words, someone will be greeted and checked for applicable a patient registration card or their age would be identified or secured to be 21. All other areas of the building outside of the retail area, as well as the restroom for any customers, are limited access areas. In other words, just accessible by staff or folks that are registered as agents or force commission staff. The doors were locked and could not be opened without an ID badge. The establishment is also fire alarms are monitored by a security company externally. Enforcement staff inspector each of the monitors that are on site at the establishment, and their camera system is capable of producing high quality images pursuant to our regulations. All the areas where marijuana is stored are found to be clean, with no visible evidence of any pests. At present, the licensee produces all of its own inventory as a currently vertically integrated R&D, and also three provisional licenses pending to that supply chain. We did confirm that the licensee plans to ensure that 35% of its inventory will remain for medical use and be preserved for intoxication. The cultivation area is divided into several rooms. That includes a cold room, meditation, and four flower rooms. We've done a square footage calculation of the facility in those specific rooms and found them to be in compliance with the under 10,000 square feet, between 5 and 10,000 square feet of total canopy, and approximately 7,600 square feet. The product manufacturing area serves as the equivalent of a commercial kitchen that manufactures edible products, which are indicated in the product manufacturing license application. They also distill oils for products using the ethanol distillation process. Their kitchen and overall production and manufacturing operation are found to be clean, orderly, and therefore in compliance with our regulations. Their retail area is clearly divided by a retractable belt barrier into two separate areas, one for medical use and the other for adult use operations. There is a patient consultation area separated from the sales floor, and educational materials are available on the sales floor for both registered patients as well as any adult use consumers. Based on all of those findings in the course of the investigations or inspections that occur, the commission staff recommends issuing the final licenses for the above referenced marijuana establishments. Those are Cultivate Holdings for Cultivation Tier 2, Cultivate Holdings for Product Manufacturer, and Cultivate Holdings for Retail final license. The licensee, with the following conditions. Those are: the licensee may cultivate, harvest, possess, prepare, produce, or otherwise acquire marijuana. Shall not dispense, sell, or otherwise transport marijuana to other marijuana establishments or to consumers until and upon inspection, receiving permission from the commission to commence full operations. The licensee is subject to the inspection audit to ascertain their compliance with our regulations, and the licensee remains suitable for licensure pursuant to our regulations. The licensee shall cooperate with and provide information to the commission's investigators, agents, and employees upon request. And lastly, the licensee shall obtain certification that it is in compliance with or has obtained the applicable waivers from the Department of Public Health as necessary, and provide such certification to the commission prior to commencing operations. This recommendation is based on the licensee's demonstrated compliance with the laws and regulations of the Commonwealth, its suitability for licensure, and upon the inspection of the licensee's marijuana establishment. The commission staff certified the due diligence review of the licensee's marijuana establishments were performed, and as of this date, the licensee has demonstrated their compliance with the laws and regulations of the Commonwealth and its suitability for licensure. Accordingly, the licensee is recommended for final licensure for the marijuana establishments previously mentioned. As part of the approval of these final licenses, the hope is that the commission will authorize staff to take all necessary actions to review compliance with the above referenced conditions and approve the commencement of operations.
Thanks to staff. Great job, and great summary. Are there questions for the executive director or for any of our enforcement or investigation staff? Commissioner Bracken.
First off, I want to say thank you very much to our licensing and investigations and section staff. They've done an incredible job of pulling together this information. I know you've been working around the clock, and so I really appreciate that. I think that this is really a statement about the hard work that has been put into this that we are at this point right now. I did have a couple of questions. My first questions are about the separation of R&D and adult use. And I wanted to throw a couple of pieces in here. First is, in the report, there was an inclusion of a picture. It's exhibit F13. It shows a sign that is separating adult use clients from medical patients. While I think that technically this does what the regulations require, we do have a provision in the regulations. baseline. And looking at this picture, I don't know that it demonstrates that that actually is the case. And so in other words, I think that if you were walking in here as a patient, you may feel as though there really is only one place for you to go. I think on reinspection, I would like, it's a really simple fix, but I would like to see the, a little different signage there reflecting that. The second question I had was on the reserving sufficient inventory. How did we ascertain and document that the applicant is going to pull back 35%? And is that something that we know now? Is it something that we're going to be checking when we go back out? How are we going to handle that?
Thank you, Commissioner. I'm going to allow the Director of Investigations to answer that question as it relates to the inspections that occurred by his team.
Could you use the microphone, please?
Thank you. That will be addressed on our final inspection when we go out to ensure that the inventory is separated as they've been instructed to do, and that they're also in compliance with the seed to sale tracking program. That also helps us monitor that.
Thank you.
Again, I'm going to just reiterate the things that we've all expressed. Do not get sufficiently recognized by how hard you've been working, so I'm going to recognize you for that. I have a question with regard to what is anticipated to happen when we have a relatively small number of marijuana retailers opening in the beginning months. And are we asking them to handle lengthy lines, ensuring that patients are taken care of and not caught in lengthy lines, or is that something that you're looking to do in the inspection prior to opening day?
That actually is a discussion we've had with the licensee. He plans on having
respective
licensees. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. He does plan to have extra staff available to assist customers to come in. We do anticipate large numbers of people coming in on opening day for these various establishments as they open.
Great, thank you. And just one follow-up. Also, the other thing that I would be concerned about with these lengthy lines is police details, et cetera. Are we connecting with the local police departments to make sure that adequate security is being provided for those patients and consumers?
Yes, an important consideration has been made for the police departments who have concerns that there will be large crowds showing up in town, and traffic issues besides the large number of people who may not be from the area. I've been very careful to communicate with the various police departments and to make sure they are aware when the establishment might open so that they can have extra officers on duty for traffic control or for other duties as necessary.
Great, thank you.
Commissioner Bryan, any other questions?
I suspect this may fall into.
I'm sorry.
This is
a
security
related. Well, go ahead and ask it if it falls in. You ask the question, and then we'll determine whether it's a burglar type possession.
So, limited access areas are only to be accessible to individuals who are specifically authorized to access them. What are the titles of the individuals who are the people who are allowed to access the limited access areas? Can we check that?
Yes.
Hold on a second. Go ahead. I'm sorry, please go ahead.
Yes, we did check that. We've got a list of positions of people who have to have access to certain areas. For example, a cultivation area is a limited access area, so only persons who are badged under the cultivation list will be allowed in those places. Same thing for the product manufacturer area. Only persons who would be badged for product manufacturer would be allowed in those areas, and similar situation for retail. The prospective licensee did provide us a list of job titles. People in management positions would have access to all three and would have to be badged and credentialed under all three licenses.
I'm thinking back here. Do you wish to have any questions?
Two questions. First,
certainly always welcome to call our office. If our information is available on our website, there's some discussion as far as developing such an equivalent hotline, and we'll be calling the message, and therefore the triage committee and other staff. Certainly a website or web form that someone can send a tip to us as well. So I think we're going to be ever vigilant as far as the clients, and also attempting, or again, endeavoring to be as accessible or available for folks that may want to give us information that we would obviously take very seriously and attempt to run down every single instance.
Do you have a second question?
My second question is, first of all, I should thank you for the excellent report. You did a really good job getting a huge volume of information and making it understandable and well-organized, in addition to all of your licensing and inspection work, so thank you for that. I was wondering if you could talk more about the investigation into the ownership of the company under our regulations, as well as control. What does that process look like? And as the regulations require any change in ownership, requires a request, were there any requests made?
Sure, Pat, do you want to top up and we'll discuss it, I guess, on the application all the way through now, if that's okay, as far as the entire application?
That's a very good question, Commissioner Tedham. At the beginning of the application process, we ask for the applicant to disclose a list of all their executives and managers, people with indirect or direct control, individuals or entities that are going to contribute 10% or more initial capital towards the overall endeavor. The first process is for them to actually list those people and provide their information. Those individuals do get sent to our third-party vendor, CSI, for a thorough background check. In addition to that, they also have to disclose, and then, I'm sorry, they also have to attest to certain things which we add to the application. So a couple of questions are asked of them when they're in the background check packet. One of them is they're certifying that there's no additional individuals or entities that might fall under our definition of who is required to be listed. We ask them to attest to that. We also ask them to attest to the fact that if they're listing a company that has an interest and it has to be disclosed, that people associated with that company individually themselves would not be falling under the definitions of who's listed to be required. In addition to that, they have to also submit several documents. We look through their articles of organization, their bylaws, their business plan, and we see if there's any additional people or entities that are listed in those documents, specifically the articles of organization. If there are people that show up that are not listed, in our first request for information that we send out, we ask them for clarity and clarification on that. We also check with the Secretary of the Commonwealth site to check the most updated articles of organization to verify that the people that they submitted to us are the people that are in fact in the articles of organization that's been submitted. And if there are any people that might be put into question that on that website, we also ask them to provide clarity to that. As far as has there been any individuals, has there been any requests to change the ownership or the structure of Cultivate Holdings? No, there has not been any requests for that as of now. The process for those things, because there are processes in place to change ownership, to change the structure of the building, to change the location, those processes are being worked out and worked on, and hopefully will be something that we can have for the commission considerations.
Any other questions?
This is a bit of a loaded question because we don't have a responsible vendor program in place until 2019, but in the interim, obviously, we're going through this process of talking about licensing, and that we do have training requirements, and that's a really important part of our what we're doing, right? Consumer education. We want to make sure that there is information that's available to consumers who come into marijuana establishments, and that means that employees need to be trained on how to convey that information. Have we reviewed training materials? If we haven't reviewed training materials, what are we going to be doing in making sure that there's fidelity to the regulatory requirement that those materials are in place in a timely fashion?
Initially, Commissioner McBride, through the application process, The applicant does have to submit a training plan. In the plan, they do have to demonstrate their knowledge of our regulations and know that they are required, one, to be compliant with the responsible vendor program eventually in July of 2019, that they are required to have 8 hours at a minimum of annual training for registered agents. They do, in some situations, list some of the specific things that they will train certain people on. From an application process up to the provisional license point, that's how we verify that. From the during the inspection.
Yeah, I can speak to during the actual inspection. We had a discussion with the person who's responsible for administering the training, and since the training hasn't completely rolled out yet, what their plans are to deliver the training. And obviously, follow-up inspections, if they don't deliver the training, we'll be reporting that back to the commission.
Any other questions?
Of its
patients approach the podium, and the stations employees to ensure the proper guidance around their retail operation. Medical use operations located on the left side of the sales floor and sells marijuana-infused products, flower, and concentrates to register patients. And the right side of the sales floor is available for adult use retail operation, which is currently vacant. The sales area is divided by retractable bell barrier posts. Customers are only granted access to a bathroom and a patient consultation room and the sales area. The patient consultation area is in a closed room that is separate from the sales floor. Education materials are available on the sales floor and in the patient consultation room for both registered patients and adult use consumers. This licensee also has a transportation plan, which is that their vehicles are compliant with our regulations. The vehicles were operated by licensees employees who will transport all marijuana from licensees Franklin Cultivation and product manufacturing operation to both of their retail stores. Vehicles are under surveillance to ensure marijuana products are securely locked. Commission staff recommends issuing a final license for the above referenced marijuana establishment with the following conditions: that the licensee may possess or otherwise acquire marijuana, but shall not dispense, sell, or otherwise transport marijuana to other marijuana establishments or to consumers until, upon inspection, receiving permission from the commission to commence their full operations. The licensee is subject to inspection and audit to ascertain compliance with the requirements listed in our regulations. The licensee remains suitable for licensure pursuant to our regulations as well. The licensee shall cooperate with and provide information to the commission's investigators, agents, and employees upon request. The licensee shall obtain certification that it is in compliance with or has obtained applicable waivers from the Department of Public Health as necessary and provide such certification to the commission prior to commencing their operations. This recommendation is based on the licensee's demonstrated compliance with the laws and regulations of the Commonwealth, its suitability for licensure upon the inspections of the licensee's marijuana establishment. Commission staff certified that a due diligence review of the licensee's establishment was performed, and as of this date, the licensee has demonstrated compliance with the laws and regulations of the Commonwealth and its suitability for licensure. Accordingly, the licensee is recommended for final license for the marijuana establishment with the previously mentioned conditions. As part of the approval of these final licenses, it is sought that the commission would authorize staff to take all necessary actions review compliance with the above reference conditions and then approve the commencement of operations. Happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Acting Director. Are there questions? Commissioner Doyle?
Yep. Same topic as the last time, wanting to ensure that patients who are going to be visiting this location are not going to be encountering difficulties with long lines and inability to access their medicine. When competing with consumers who are also seeking to access the product, and then also to highlight the comment of Commissioner McBride on the last applicant with regard to how patients are being accommodated and are they able to use those lines as they should be.
The patients are brought in and they're accompanied by staff, and they're able to go to either side if they are medical patients. The prospective licensees ensure us they will have adequate staff on hand on opening day to accommodate any crowds they anticipate. And we'll also notify the police department to make sure that they're aware that there will be a large number of people on opening day to help manage traffic.
And I will note that this is also dispensary that was one of the original medical applicants, so they have experience with the long lines, but you're satisfied that they've been in communication with the police department and appropriate steps are being taken to address any security issues?
I did have a conversation with the chief of police in Northampton. She was very comfortable with the security arrangements there and that they would have enough people working, and she would also have enough officers working to deal with any crowd or traffic issues.
Thank you very much.
Any questions? Commissioner Pettit?
Three questions. The first is just the same question again. Were there any requests to approve a change in ownership as required by regulation?
Commissioner Pettit, no. For NETA in this particular license, provisional licensing, no, there wasn't a request to change of any ownership.
The second question is, I saw the last application reference. education materials. I didn't take that here, so I just wanted to ask.
He was here, Commissioner.
Okay, and then the last question is, given you know how long we've been operating, I feel pretty comfortable with the operational requirements. But in general, for those that have been operating as R&Ds, do we have access to see from the DPH investigators any previous deficiency statements just so our investigators can have them?
When we were actually out doing the investigation, the inspection of NETA, they did provide us with a copy of their last inspection. As far as ongoing and how if we will have access to that from DPH or from the applicants, I can say that we can probably definitely request it of the applicants. For DPH, it's something that we would definitely need to talk about more. I'm not sure if there's already an existing memorandum of understanding to have access to those.
Thank you.
As far as our ongoing session process, we do have a good relationship. And now a memorialized relation as far as information shared with the Department of Public Health. And prior to bringing any applicant forward either for provisional or final lessons, we will communicate with the Department of Public Health to ensure that nothing has changed in that interview. Thank you.
It might be the same answer, but upon the transfer of the medical coroner, that we then have access to those records?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you. Commissioner
Gordon. Wrong, but isn't it also as a matter of the application process that they need to be disclosing that information to us as well? So there's a particular issue that they aren't disclosing yet?
Absolutely. And also as far as the suitability, anything that we don't put in on these laws also reflect there as well.
Are there any questions? I'm going to request that we take a 10-minute break and then reconvene. So we'll be watching that and pass on. Okay, we are reconvening as of 1:11 p.m. This is going to be part of my talk, I suspect, but I wanted to add to the comments by my fellow commissioners about the work that our investigations and enforcement staff has done. I think you've done a thorough job. I think you've summarized it in a very effective manner. You've answered questions, I think, very articulately and deeply. So I just wanted to pass along or add my thanks and recognition of the work that your teams have done. Thank you. At this point, if there are no objections from my fellow commissioners, I am willing to sustain a motion or consider a motion to vote on final licenses.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Commissioner Klein.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to put a motion forward on two additional conditions. that being met by licensees.
Just be so slowly so I can make sure.
I would two additional conditions to be met before licensees commence operations here in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. I'd like the commission to receive copies of training materials that they're using to train their employees, and I'd also like the commission.
Yes.
I also like copies of the educational materials that are being provided to consumers and to medicinal patients in the facilities.
I'm sorry, copies of education materials provided to consumers in the facility, right?
Yes. I think we've all talked about the importance of training employees here, and so that employees know what they need to do while they're working at these facilities. And I think it's also important that we have educational materials available for consumers in Massachusetts, and we'd like to have these as part of the investigations going forward.
Thank you. So your motion is to add two requirements to the recommendation that that staff has made. So right now there are five, and you're suggesting two more conditions. Is that correct?
Yes, Mr. Chair. Okay.
Can I have a second for that motion?
Second.
All in favor? Okay, go ahead. Copies, but also as you can have them being displayed.
Yes. So, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to amend my motion by stating that we would like to receive copies of training materials being utilized by the licensee, and also copies of education materials and the method by which they are being disseminated to the public.
Thank you. Can I have a second on that motion? Thank you. I'll let the record show that the motion was made by Commissioner Fines and seconded by Commissioner McBride. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. The motion carries unanimously. Yes, Commissioner Powell. Yes, please.
I have a motion to add an additional condition that commission staff will inspect any contractual obligations. That the commission staff will inspect any contractual obligations that may rise to the level of control.
Inspect any contractual obligations that may rise to the level of control. Did I get that right? Do you wish to make a motion? Yours is done, so this is just a separate motion. Okay, then can I have a second on Commissioner Travel's motion?
Second.
I'm sorry.
Second.
Thanks. Let the record show Commissioner Travel made a motion to approved for additional condition, seconded by Commissioner McBride. Condition is that the commission staff will inspect any contractual obligations that may arise to the level of control. All in favor?
Corporation or entity shall be determined to be in a position to control the decision making.
Yes.
Okay.
Then I'm fine.
Yeah,
I'm ready.
Any other discussion before we have to vote on the motion?
So we now are at a place where I would entertain a motion to, I think we need to do this one by one. I would entertain a motion to vote on the final license application of Cultivate Holdings LLC, MC 281266, Cultivation Tier 2, subject to the five conditions that are in the memo from staff and the three additional conditions that we just voted on. Can I have a second, please?
Second.
Chair, Commissioner Flanagan made a motion to approve, seconded by Commissioner Doyle. All in favor?
Aye.
Discussion?
Can I get
a motion? Sure. So the motion is to accept the staff recommendation for Cultivate Holdings LLC, MC 281266, Tier 2 Cultivation, subject to the conditions that are in the staff memo, plus the three conditions that we just added as in our last two votes. Is that missing any of that?
I sound very brief. Discussion. I respect the policy that the commission has that we won't review post community agreements, so I will not try to review them, nor will I try to deny the license to the applicant. However, for reasons I've already made clear and how much this process rests on the community agreement process, with respect to my legal obligation, I can't affirmatively vote yes when I've seen the agreements, and they're questionable, I guess. So I'll be abstaining from the vote.
Thank you. Any other comments before we move to Mr. Rose? Can I ask for, I guess, vote in favor of the staff recommendation? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Commissioner Tyrell, you're abstaining, is that correct?
I see.
And so let the record show that this motion was approved by the commission on a vote of 4 in favor, Commissioners McBride, Commissioner Doyle, Commissioner Flanagan, and Commissioner Hoffman, and then Commissioner Tyrell abstaining. Thank you. I would next like to entertain a motion to approve Cultivate Holdings LLC, MP 281305, product manufacturer, subject to the five conditions that are in the staff recommendation and the three additional conditions that were just voted on by the commission. Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Can I have a second, please?
Second.
That's where Commissioner Doyle made a motion to approve, seconded by Commissioner Flanagan. Is there any discussion before we put this to vote? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Commissioner Tanner, you are abstaining, is that correct? Thank you. So let the record show this commission was, this motion was approved by a vote of 4 in favor of Commissioner McBride, Doyle, Hoffman, and Flanagan, and Commissioner Tanner abstaining. Thank you very much. I'd like to next entertain a motion to approve the staff recommendation for Cultivate Holdings LLC, MR 281268 for retailer, subject to the five conditions that were in the staff memo, plus the three conditions that we added in our votes previously. May I have such a motion, please?
So moved.
Can I have a second, please?
Second.
Let the record Commissioner Doyle made a motion to approve, seconded by Commissioner McBride. Is there any discussion before we put this to a vote? Then may I ask all in favor? All opposed? Commissioner Tyler, you are abstaining, is that correct?
Yes,
thank you. So let the record show this motion was approved by a vote of 4 in favor, 1 opposed, 1 abstention. In favor were Commissioners McBride, Doyle, Hoffman, Flanagan, and Commissioner Tyler abstaining. Next, I would like to consider a motion to approve staff recommendation for amendment treatment access LLC, MR 281240 for retailer. Subject to the five conditions that the staff rep put into their memo, as well as the three conditions we added subsequently in our votes. Can I have a motion, please? Can I have a second, please? Let the record Commissioner Doyle made a motion to approve, seconded by Commissioner McBride. Is there any discussion before we put this to a vote? Okay, then all in favor? All opposed? Commissioner Cannon, you are abstaining, is that correct?
Yes,
thank you. That's Berkshire. This motion is approved by the commission by a vote of 4 in favor, none opposed, with 1 abstention. In favor of Commissioner McBride, who are often the flag in it. Commissioner Tyler was saying, thank you. Unless there are any further questions with respect to the 4 final licenses that we just approved, I would suggest that we move on, as executive director, to the 7 provisional licenses. Mr. Executive Director, if you could do your summary, please, of these 7 provisional licenses that are up for review, starting with, there are 4 from Berkshire Roots and 3 from Organic LLC, 3 Organic LLC. So my understanding is you're going to go through Berkshire together. If you would mind, and if you miss your summary, I'd report Berkshire Roots applications for provisional license.
Similar to the format for the now approved final licenses, I'll present them in a manner that's collective for the entity that break out. If there's any indication for a license specific topic or item, I'll identify that. However, the entity here seeking licenses, Berkshire Roots Incorporated, the proposed address of the establishment is 501 Delta Avenue, Pittsfield. The license is being sought for that establishment. In that location are tier 2 cultivation, which authorizes up to 10,000 square feet, product manufacturing, retail, as well as transportation with an existing marijuana establishment license. This applicant is not a licensed applicant for any other marijuana establishment licenses. The individuals identified as far as the role within the establishment are Albert Wotowski, Kurt Costa, Dennis Apollo, Stephanie Ospel, Joseph Allergian, Thomas McNamee, Andrea Zafaro, and Matthew Feeney. The entity associated with the license for application is Cable Resources LLC, which owns Berkshire Roots Incorporated. The applicant certified that no other entities or individuals who may have interest in Cable Resources LLC and who would otherwise be required to be individually listed in the license application have been omitted. This applicant is an R&D priority applicant. The R&D is in compliance currently with the Department of Public Health, and the business is proposed to be co-located with their medical use of the building's business in Pittsfield, and this R&D has obtained their final certificate of registration for dispensing, cultivating, and processing. The review was executed on May 24th, and certification has been provided to that effect. The community R&D meeting was held on May 8th. The notice was published at least 7 days prior from the Berkshire people. There were no objections raised or communicated to the commission. Commission received responses from the municipality on the following dates, September 7th for the detailed license application, and September 12th for cultivation, product manufacturing, and transportation for the establishment license. Municipality certified the applicant is in compliance with all local ordinances and bylaws for all licenses being sought. Their plan to positively impact areas of disproportionate impact includes impacting the city of Pittsfield in the following ways: prioritizing the hiring of local and disadvantaged workers, conducting community outreach in order to promote health, wellness, and cannabis education, and at a minimum supporting one local charitable organization that participates in health, wellness, and human services. The applicant plans to evaluate and measure the success of their actions annually to ensure that their goals are being achieved. There are no concerns raised during the background check on individuals or entities associated with the application, and no disclosure of any past civil or criminal actions or any occupational license issues. The applicant did not disclose any business interest in other jurisdictions. They secured a certificate of good standing from the Department of Revenue as well as the Secretary of State. And their plan to become operational in the timeline is that they are vertically integrated R&D that is operational in the adult use market, and are able to be operational in the adult use market within 2 weeks from being issued a license. The proposed hours of operation are cultivation and product manufacturing 24 hours a day, Monday through Sunday, and a retail transportation operation on Tuesday through Sunday, 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. to be closed on Mondays. They have submitted the required summaries and plans, policies, and procedures. We've evaluated those summaries and determined them to be substantially compliant with our regulations. Of course, full compliance will be reviewed during our inspection process and will be required before final license is issued. The diversity plan includes the following: building a diverse staff that is comparable to the demographics of Pittsfield, building relationships with diverse institutions in order to recruit and hire potential employees, and continuing to search for and remove barriers for people of diverse backgrounds to ensure that they have access to opportunities within the goals by doing the following: collecting and analyzing demographic data to compare to this organization's diversity, performing exit surveys and collecting employment data to improve diversity and overall retention of its employees, and lastly, developing a written plan for continuous improvement. Their plan, the summary of their cultivation plan includes obtaining particular strains, propagation stage, flowering stage, and harvesting stage. The applicant plans to install and implement sustainable and environmentally conscious amenities, equipment, and lighting for its cultivation facility with the goal of reducing its overall carbon footprint. The products to be sold or produced include vaporizer cartridges, oils, cookies, brownies, chocolates, tinctures, lozenges, cannabis infused mineral waters, patches, and salts. They plan to obtain marijuana products so that they are vertically integrated in R&D, and that they're applying for adult use cultivation and product manufacturing licenses. If the need arises, it's planned to procure additional supplies of marijuana establishments licensed by the commission. Commission staff recommends issuing four provisional licenses to the applicant with the following conditions: that the final license is subject to certification that the applicant remains in compliance with EPH regulations, the final license is subject to inspection and audit to ascertain compliance with our regulations, the final license is subject to inspection and audit to ascertain that their facilities are compliant with all applicable state and local codes, bylaws, ordinances, and regulations, that the applicant shall operate with and provide information to the commission's investigators, agents, and employees upon request. And lastly, the provisional license is subject to the payment of the appropriate license fee pursuant to our regulations. This recommendation is based on the applicant's demonstrated compliance with the laws and regulations of the Commonwealth, its suitability for licensure, and upon the evaluation of the thoroughness of the applicant's responses to the required criteria. We certify that we have a due diligence review, and that as of this date, the applicant has demonstrated their compliance with the laws and regulations of the Commonwealth, and its suitability for licensure. Accordingly, the applicant is recommended for the four provisional licenses previously mentioned.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Director. Other questions? I ask for a motion to approve the first license, Berkshire Roots Incorporated, NCN 281590, Cultivation Tier 2.
So moved.
Can I have a second, please?
Second.
The clerk show that Commissioner Flanagan made a motion to approve, seconded by Commissioner Doyle. Is there any discussion before it gets to a vote? And may, all in favor? The Berkshire Commission has approved the staff recommendation for Berkshire Roots NCN 281590. Can I ask a motion, please, to vote on to approve the staff recommendation for Berkshire Roots Incorporated NPN 281427 product manufacturing?
So moved.
I'm sorry.
So moved.
Second. The Berkshire Commission McBride made a motion to approve, seconded by Commissioner Flanagan. Is there any discussion before we go to a vote? All in favor?
Aye.
The commission, the director of the commission, has approved Berkshire Roots Incorporated NPN 281427. I would like to ask for a motion to approve Berkshire Roots Incorporated NRN 281585 retailer. Can I have a second motion, please? Can I have a second, please?
Second.
The director of the commission, go ahead and make a motion to approve, seconded by Commissioner McBride. Any discussion? Reference to vote? And all in favor?
Aye.
The record show the commission unanimously approved staff recommendation for Berkshire Roots Incorporated MRN 281585 retailer. I'd like to ask for a motion to approve staff recommendation with respect to Berkshire Roots Incorporated MXN 281322 transporter with other existing marijuana establishment license. Can I have a motion to approve the staff recommendation? Can I have a second, please?
Second.
The director, Commissioner Doyle, made a motion to approve, seconded by Commissioner McBride. Are there any discussion before we move to the vote? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
I'm sorry, this is good. Thank you. The director of staff unanimously approved the early commission, unanimously approved the recommendation of staff with respect to Berkshire Roots Incorporated MXN 281322. Thank you very much. I think next are three applications from 253 Organic LLC. Mr. Executive Director.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As we begin, the entity applying for marijuana establishment license is 253 Organic LLC. Those addresses of the establishment is 253 Miller's Falls Road in Montague. And the licenses being sought by the entity are Tier 4 cultivation. licensee or applicant for any other marijuana establishment license. The individuals in their roles within the establishment are Seth Rutherford, Christopher Gallant, Alan Shore, Marshall White, and Lee Wilson. There are no other entities other than the applicant that appear to have direct or indirect authority over the establishment, and this applicant is not a priority applicant. It remains a general applicant. The host community agreement was executed on April 2nd. Certification has been provided. The community outreach meeting was held on March 27th, with notice published at least 7 days prior in the Montague Reporter. There were no objections communicated to the commission. We received a response from the municipality on September 17th stating that the applicant is in compliance with all local ordinances and bylaws. Their plan to positively impact areas of disproportionate impact includes conducting job fairs in Greenfield, Holyoke, and Amherst, offering job assessments and providing guidance for interested parties to receive trainings on positions available with the applicant, making annual donations to local community initiatives, and providing employee time to participate in community service activities related to substance abuse prevention, senior assistance, and veteran assistance. There were no concerns raised during the background check on individuals or entities associated with the application. There were disclosures of past civil or criminal actions, however, none of those disclosures presented suitability issues. Similarly, there were disclosures of occupational license issues, however, those disclosures did not present suitability issues either. Seth Rutherford and Christopher Gallant disclosed that they both have a business interest and a medical marijuana provider in Maine called Maine Jane LLC. This does not represent any suitability issues related to that disclosure. They did secure their certificate of standing from the Secretary of the Commonwealth as well as the Department of Revenue. Their proposed timeline to become operational includes, upon receiving a provisional license, the applicant will apply for a building permit. Once the building permit is approved, and after an architectural plan is submitted and approved by the commission, the applicant states that it could be operational in approximately 11 months. The applicant's proposed hours of operation include cultivation product manufacturing Monday through Sunday, 7 a.m. to 6 p.m., retail operations Monday through Sunday, 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. The applicant submitted required summaries of plans, policies, and procedures. Those summaries have been determined to be substantially compliant with our regulations. We will determine full compliance upon reviewing them during the inspection process, and full compliance will be required before a final license is issued. The diversity plan includes the following goals. By the second year of being open for business, the applicant has a goal that its workforce will be comprised 30% female and or minority employees. About 50 are being open for business. The applicant has a goal that its workforce will be comprised of 50% female and or minority employees. To accomplish this goal, the applicant plans to do the following: conducting career fairs to attract diverse employees, and scheduling and conducting formal interviews specifically with individuals from diverse communities. Their cultivation plan summary includes the following information related to their cultivation process, the various strains it plans to propagate, growth medium that will utilize, the lighting standards that will be utilized, and lastly, monitoring and tracking the plants throughout the growth and harvesting stages. The list of products that will be produced include the following: baked goods, hard and soft candy, tinctures, drinks, oil cartridges, vape pens, wax, and shatter. They plan to obtain marijuana products that they've applied for adult use cultivation and product manufacturing licenses, and it plans to supply its own marijuana and marijuana products. If need arises, the applicant will obtain marijuana from other licensed marijuana establishments. The commission staff recommends issuing provisional licenses to the applicant with the following conditions. The final license is subject to inspection and audit to ascertain compliance with our regulations. The final license is subject to inspection and audit to ascertain that the facilities are compliant with all applicable state and local codes, bylaws, ordinances, and regulations. The applicant shall cooperate with and provide information to the commission's investigators, agents, and employees upon request. And lastly, the provisional license is subject to the payment of the appropriate license fee pursuant to our regulations. This recommendation is based on the applicant's demonstrated compliance with the laws and regulations of the Commonwealth, and suitability for licensure, and upon the evaluation of the thoroughness of the applicant's responses to required criteria. We certify that we've done a due diligence review of the application, and as of this date, the applicant has demonstrated compliance with the laws and regulations of the Commonwealth, and suitability for licensure, and accordingly, the applicant is recommended for a provisional license with the previously mentioned conditions.
Thank you, Mr. Executive Director. Are there questions?
Just a clarification on the diversity plan. Am I reading it correctly that with regard to the goals, after 2 years of being open for business,
workforce that is 70% neither female nor minority and meet their goals.
So the motion to speak, the motion is to approve the staff recommendation subject to the addition of the additional conditions suggested by Commissioner Pato for the previous license.
So moved.
I think we should do that. Who moved to the second? Just for the record, second the motion?
Second.
Okay, so the motion was made by Commissioner Pato, seconded by Commissioner Boyle. All in favor? Is there any discussion? All in favor? Has to approve staff recommendation for organic organic NPN 281202 subject to the additional condition requested by Mr. Tyler for the previous license. The next is 253 Organic LLC MRN 281245 retailer. I'd like to ask for a motion to approve the staff recommendation subject to the additional condition requested by Commissioner Tyler for the previous two licenses. Director Commissioner Doyle made a motion to approve, seconded by Commissioner McBride. All in favor?
Aye.
Director Commissioner has to approve staff recommendation for 253 Organic LLC MRN 281245, subject to the additional condition requested by Commissioner Tyler for the previous two licenses. Thank you. Mr. Executive Director, anything else on these provisional licenses? Thank you. I'm going to, in a few seconds, then ask for a motion to recess. I wanted to, before I do that, just cover two logistical things. First, I just wanted to show everybody where we got to in our agenda today, and therefore what we're going to be covering when we reconvene. So we finish provisional licenses. The remaining agenda items, which I'll get to, are commission discussion and possible vote on the municipal survey data. Discussion on social consumption, the office procurement discussion, both the satellite and headquarters office. And again, I'm giving everybody a heads up that we are likely to go into executive session for the discussion of office space procurement, and we are likely to adjourn from executive session, but we'll go through that when we meet on Tuesday morning. So the motion is to reconvene on Tuesday morning, cover the agenda that I just went through, and the meeting, we will be meeting on October 9th at the Gaming Commission offices on the 12th floor on General Street at 9 a.m. So I'd like to make a motion to recess until 9 a.m. on the night of October at the Massachusetts Commission and cover the remaining agenda as well. So I'd like to make that motion. Can I have a second, please? Second, Chairman Hopkins, motion to recess. Second, Commissioner McBride, all in favor?
Aye.
Let's make sure that we are in recess until 9 a.m. Tuesday morning. Thank you very much, everybody.
Limit, right? And if you use it, it's kind of like
I gotta grab a side chair.